So today, we are back in Ephesians, and we're finishing up part two of a two-part sermon here in Ephesians on this longest Greek sentence in the Bible. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14 is the longest Greek sentence in the Bible. And so I wanted to tie these two sermons together. And we couldn't do it all in one week because, well, I just couldn't. So we're going to do it in two. And so we're going to review a little bit what we talked about last week, and we're going to pick up some new this week. But hopefully as we look at this, we're going to get some truths from this, maybe some new truths as we understand this one sentence as a whole rather than the pieces. What I've learned, and pastors are terrible at this, is that sometimes we can miss the forest for the trees. Okay, we get caught up in the little details, we get caught up in the little phrases, and we miss how the whole thing ties together. And I'm not saying that I'm perfect at that, but as I was reading through this, there were some things that tied this whole thing together. And I just want to look at that with you as we kind of grasp this so that we don't do that. We don't miss the large picture because little details that are shared in this passage. Before we begin, let's go to prayer. God, we're coming to you today. And Lord, as always, we need your wisdom. God, help me as I try to communicate these truths. And Father, help us all to be receptive to what you have to say. There are different things going on in our lives. Lord, some of us today are joyful. Some of us today are hurting. Some of us today, we need to have a better relationship with you. Some of us today may need to have a relationship period with you. God, I don't know where people are. Lord, I know we're all over the board, and that's okay because that's part of life. But Father, you speak to all of us no matter where we are. And today I'd ask that you would speak to us. You would help us to bring out the truths that you need or that you want for us where we are at today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, again, Ephesians chapter 1 is where we are. In your bulletins, you'll find an outline. There's a simple fill-in-the-blank outline there to help you track with us today. I tried to make it a little simple for you this week, and hopefully that'll help you as we follow along with this. But the idea of the sermon is this idea right here. It says, in the longest Greek sentence in the Bible, Paul references things we have in Christ 9 times. Understanding the implications of this emphasis is important so we can properly understand what we have in Christ. This is the same thing that we talked about last week. We're just continuing on in this. As we look at this passage, oftentimes especially we as pastors, okay, but if we study the scriptures, we get caught up in this whole idea of, well, election. What does God mean by election? What does God mean? He chose us before the foundation of the world. And we get caught up in those things. We try to understand those things, and we miss the fact that the sentences in English aren't there in Greek. It's all one complete sentence, 202 words long. It's all tied together. It all flows together. So you can't just pull out sections and get caught up in the sections because you'll miss something. You'll miss the whole. To a degree, you might miss the whole. And so I want us to combine all these things together and see what exactly is it. Well, when you look at the whole thing, when you're studying a passage, one of the things you should always do when you're studying a passage is say, okay, is there a specific theme to this passage? Is there a theme that's being repeated over and over and over again? Does there seem to be an emphasis in this passage? And in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14, we see the emphasis in this passage is this in Christ, or in the Beloved, in Him. 9 times Paul repeats that. That seems like an emphasis to me. That seems like a recurring theme to me. So what do we do with that? Well, let's look at this for just a minute. What does the word in mean? We're going to go back to this. We're going to review this. Kind of a look back at what we talked about last week. What does the word in mean? Many of us know this. We're going to look at it anyway. In the Greek, it's the word in, literally in. Epsilon and nu is the Greek letters that's used. Epsilon, the first letter, and then nu is the last letter. And it says in. And it means this. It indicates inclusion, location, or position within limits. All right? Fish live in water. Do fish live outside of water? No, they live in water, right? This is what they do. We understand that. Whereas people, we don't live in water, do we? We can create habitats that will help us exist down there, but we cannot live in a world that's all it is water. We need oxygen and things like that, right? So we understand that we cannot live in water. Fish live in water. So we live where there's air, okay? We need air to breathe. We understand that. Trees live on dry ground. All these different things happen. We understand the word in limits things. So when we're looking at this Ephesians passage, understanding the word in limits things, and what's the word in refer to? In Christ, in Him. So in Christ, in Him, that's our limitation. So what happens in Christ? What is it that happens in Christ that cannot happen outside of Christ? Because there's a difference, there's a contrast. We have in and we have out. We understand opposites, okay? You have in and you have out. So if we understand these things happen in Christ, then we also must understand that we're going to make an assumption here that those things do not happen outside of Christ. Does that make sense as well? Hopefully. Nod your heads this way. Perfect. Great. Thank you. Give me a little encouragement today. Here we go. So what do we receive in Him? So here's a review. Last week, some things we talked about. Last week, in Him, we receive every spiritual blessing. Every spiritual blessing. That's verse 3, Ephesians 1, verse 3. Every spiritual blessing we receive. We receive a relationship with God. Verse 4, we receive grace, we receive redemption, we receive forgiveness, we receive hope. These are things that Paul emphasized in the very first part of this passage that we receive in Christ. So, again, opposites being what they are. Outside of Christ, you're not going to have these things. So if you're sitting there and you're looking at your life and you think, man, God, I need some blessings in my life. I need some grace. I need forgiveness. I need hope. I need a relationship with God that can only be found in Christ. That's where those things come from. So if in your life you're missing some pieces here, the first question is, well, am I in Christ? Okay, that's a fair question to ask. If you are, then there's a time when we come to where we have a relationship with Christ and we have a fellowship. Okay, relationship and fellowship. My children are always going to be in relationship with me because we're related, right? Sometimes we may not be in right fellowship, though, based upon their actions. You understand what I mean? Okay? So we can be in relationship and be out of fellowship. And when we're out of fellowship, sometimes you can miss these things too. But you're never going to get those things if you're not in relationship first. Okay? So ask yourself, am I in relationship first? And if you're in relationship, then now you ask, am I in fellowship? Because they're two different questions. And the book of Ephesians talks about both of those things, our position and our condition in Christ, referring to my relationship with Christ, my fellowship with Christ. All right, so here we go. We have these things are what we receive, the first six things that Paul lists there, and under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we receive in Him. So let's look now at the latter part. In Ephesians 1, verse 11, that's where we're going to be. Ephesians 1, verse 11. It says this, in Him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of Him who works all things according to the counsel of His will. So what do we get? What's the in Him we get from this? Well, we get an inheritance. And as I looked at this, I thought, you know what? An inheritance, what's that give me? An inheritance gives me value. How many of you wish you had more value in this life? And I don't mean worth, but how many of you sometimes we doubt our self-worth, so to speak? Not physical worth, but our self-worth, right? We've been there. We have days where we're like that. And God, I just don't feel that important. I wish I had something. Well, in Him, we have an inheritance. Now, what's an inheritance? An inheritance is something that you get because you're related to somebody. Does that make sense? Right? We inherit those things. Now, we're going to talk about this in a minute, but I want us to think. An inheritance only comes after what occurs? Death. Think about that for a moment. You don't get an inheritance from your parents if your parents are still living. That's kind of cold to ask for them, okay? In fact, there's a parable in the Bible that talks about that, right? But it's kind of cold to go up to your mom and dad and say, you know what? I know you're still living. Can I have my inheritance now? Anyway? And that's going to be a little cold, all right? They just don't really like that. And don't threaten to send Guido either, because they don't like that either. So I'm just saying, don't try to get your inheritance before they pass away naturally, all right? These are things that happen. But in order for inheritance to come, death has to occur. But there's a value in that. There is, when you go to the lawyer, and you're sitting in front of the lawyer, and the will is read, to that lawyer, you are somebody who's about to receive something, something amazing. On that piece of paper, it lists you as a beneficiary of something. There's value in that. And God says, you have value. I have an inheritance set aside for you. In my Son, there's inheritance. You have value. You have value. That's what God wants us to understand. Is that when this inheritance, as we think about this, there's value that we have in our lives today. Now, I want to look at this word inheritance for just a minute here, because there's some understanding in this. This phrase, obtained an inheritance. In Him, we've obtained an inheritance. When you understand this in the original language, and I'm going to try to explain this to you, and forgive me, okay? Because this may be boring to you, but I want to make it exciting. Because there are some things that really hit me that may not hit you, but I'm going to try to help it just tweak your interest just a little bit. But as I was studying this phrase, in Him, we've obtained an inheritance. Well, that's kind of cold when you sit and think about it. Because, well, let's get into this, let's figure out what it is. The Greek word is kleru, and it literally means appoint by lot. Okay, they take one word, obtained inheritance, all right, and this one word kleru, and they make the words obtained an inheritance, all right. Well, there's another word for inheritance, and that's kleronomia, okay, right down there, and that means inheritance. That's what that means. That's found in verse 14 of chapter 1. Verse 14 of chapter 1. So how do we understand that? Well, what we're trying to do is you put these things together, and we're trying to, when we translate to the English, we try to get the idea, sometimes the idea of what the author is saying, and there are words that aren't used anywhere else, okay, such as kleru isn't used anywhere else, and so we try to put some meaning to that. Okay, and trying to understand. So they put the meaning obtain and inheritance. The ESV put that meaning to that. Well, here's some other options that we can look at. I have two opinions of what it could be. My opinion A, we were made partakers of the inheritance. And as I did my studying, as I read some Greek theologians and different things like that, there was two that came out as the top two, and I'm going to show both of those. One of those was suggested right here. We were made partakers of an inheritance, okay? Now think about that. To obtain an inheritance is to what? That's to get, right? We receive something. When you're a child and you receive a gift from your parents, that's exciting, isn't it? Okay? But what if you're a child and your parents give you a gift and they say, we're going to share this together, we're going to do this together. How much more exciting is that as a kid? Well, as a kid, that was way more exciting. When my dad got me something, said, we're doing this together, and then we sat down and did it together, that was way more meaningful than just getting the gift. Does that make sense? For my dad to get me a shotgun and say, hey, go hunting by yourself was one. But when my dad took time to go with me, that was what was incredible. When he partook of the gift with me. So what's this saying here? We were made partakers of the inheritance. Well, let's look at some different verses. In Colossians 1:12, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Okay, so we're sharing with others. That's what we understand here. We're sharing this inheritance with others. In Ephesians 1, verse 3, Ephesians 1, 3, going back to that one, says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. And then jumping down to verse 14, talks about the Holy Spirit, who is a guarantee of our inheritance. Okay, so there's inheritance there. But if we think about it as we are partakers of the inheritance, that means we're sharing this. It's not something for me. It's not something just for mine that somebody's given to me and then walked away. There's a relationship involved. And that's why this was so exciting to me, because as I sit and think about my inheritance revolves around relationship. It's not just something cold, hey, here's a gift. Not that that's cold, but to a degree, it's much colder than it is, hey, let's share this together. Do you understand what I'm saying? Do you understand why to me this was significant? To be the idea that we are partakers of this. Well, the other opinion is this. My opinion B. Now, do you understand the word opinion? What this means is if you disagree with me, it's fine. All right? I'm not going to die on a mountain here. All right? These are my opinions. So my opinion B, we were made a heritage. All right? And we're going to go to Ephesians 1:18 where it says, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he's called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. Well, who's the his? Who's the his glorious inheritance in the saints? Well, it's talking about Christ. So, am I a partaker of an inheritance? Do I share an inheritance? Or am I Christ's inheritance? Think about that for a moment. That I am Christ's inheritance. That I am part of that. That I am what Christ is looking forward to. Now, that's also exciting for me, isn't it? To be one of those two things. Either one of those is great. Okay? Either one of those gives me value. It helps me understand that my life has value. So, which one is it? Well, here's my conclusion. And this is a very theologically profound conclusion, so I hope you appreciate it. It beats me. I got no idea, okay? I'm just saying that these two ideas both have merit. They do. They both have merit. Both are something to consider. Both of them help us maybe gain a little bit more value just in who we are in Christ. In Christ. Because what I know is this. I know it happens in Christ. Whether I'm a partaker of the inheritance or whether I am an inheritance, it happens in Christ. Both of those give me value. Both of those do. And that's what I like about that. Both of those do. All right, next verse, Ephesians 1:12. So that we who are the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. Now that's, you know, you kind of break that up a little bit because it comes in verse 11. Understanding, again, this is all one sentence. In him we've attained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. What does that mean? What am I in Christ? What do I get in Christ? Well, I get this. I get purpose. And he's like, well, what do you mean you get purpose? Well, think about this for just a second. When it goes to this, so that we who are to the first hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. We have a purpose. We are here to be the praise of God's glory. We're supposed to show, we can show people, we can lead people to see what God's glory can be in their life. We can praise God for the things that he has done. We have reason to live. Hebrews chapter 12 says this, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. All right, back up to verse 1 for just a minute. There we go. Therefore, since we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, lay aside, let's run with endurance, all right? Looking to Jesus. That's our focus, looking to Jesus. Today, the ladies they sang the song, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. How many times in our life is it easy to forget the cross? How many times is it? It's easy, isn't it? And Jesus is saying here, on the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he's telling Paul, he says this, so that we who are the first hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. We need to be praising God. The author of Hebrews says this, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who what did he do? For the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, seated at the right hand of the throne of God. And later on in this same chapter, just a few verses on in this same chapter, going on this course just a little bit, he gives a big therefore. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, and thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe. Do you understand what we're supposed to be here? To the praise of his glory? And you tie all that in with Hebrews chapter 12, and you look at this, and you think, my goodness, I have a reason to live. I've got value. I've got a reason to live. I've got purpose. There's something God wants me to do. Why? Because of what Christ has done. Looking to Jesus. And what happens when we come in churches like this? When we come to family reunions, we got a family get-together here coming up in just a few days. All right? Now, every family has the crazy uncle. Right? My family thinks I'm it. You laugh. All right? My nieces and nephews are convinced I am the crazy uncle, okay? Because when you look around, everyone else is normal. It's got to be you, okay? And so we look at that. And my family get-together is going to be interesting. And sometimes those family get-togethers, what do you need? You need a little grace, don't you? You need grace. You need a little forgiveness. You need a little understanding. You need a little Jesus, don't you? Church is just like that. Sometimes on a Sunday morning, we need a little bit of grace, a little bit of forgiveness, a little bit of understanding, and a whole lot of Jesus. Looking to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom. And let us do what? Let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe. And all of the things that we face, with the people we face them with, we should never forget what God has done for us. And we should praise God for it. Yeah, life kicks us sometimes, doesn't it? We talked a few weeks ago how on some Sunday mornings, frankly, there are some people who are just aren't cheerful because of what's going on in life. That happens, doesn't it? But on all of this, there is a reason for us to praise God. Some days we don't feel like it. I confess that. Some days I don't feel like it. But I've always got a reason to praise God. And when does that happen? Well, when I take my eyes off of me, and I turn, and I look at that. That's when that happens, looking to Jesus. And when we look to Jesus, he gives us purpose. And we can fulfill that purpose that he has for us. He has given us an inheritance. He's given us value. And he's given us a purpose, a reason to live. This is what God has done for us. Why? To the praise of his glory. All those things. We have value and we have purpose. How? In him. These things, again, they happen in him. The final verses, Ephesians 1, 13 and 14, in him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who was the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. Before we discuss what we get in him, we're going to do a little bunny trail. You guys ever heard of bunny trails before? I had a pastor who was notorious for bunny trails. He called them rabbit trails. I'm going to do one, and I'm announcing it. I'm making it official. This is it. Rabbit trail. What is the gospel? You say, well, where did that question come from? Well, right back here. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. All right? So we're going to clarify. Before we get into the in him, we're going to say, well, what first? What is the gospel? So here's my rabbit trail. What is the gospel? Well, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 shares very clearly what this is. And I'm going to read verse 1 to you. And then we're going to have verses 3 and 4 up on the screen. 1 Corinthians 15. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved. Okay, you tracking with me? So Paul is saying, this is the gospel. I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you. In the verses 3 and 4, here's what he says. This is the gospel. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. To summarize that in 10 words, Christ died for our sins and rose from the dead. That is the gospel. That's the gospel. So understanding that this is the gospel, we go back to Ephesians chapter 1, all right, verses 13 and 14, where it says this. It says, in him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. What's the gospel again? Christ died for our sins and rose from the dead. So when I heard the gospel, that Christ died for my sins and rose from the dead, and then I believe the gospel, that Christ died for my sins and rose from the dead, all right, you tracking with me? Then what happened? I was sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. So when I heard the gospel and I believed the gospel, I was sealed with the Holy Spirit, who is the promise of my inheritance, who is the promise of all those things. He's the guarantor of all those things. So what do I get? I get assurance. That's what I get. In him, I get assurance. I have hope for the future. Okay? I have value, I have purpose, and I have hope. All of these things happening in him. Not outside of him, but in him these things happen. Hebrews says it this way, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Did you catch this part right here? Full assurance. That's what we get. We get assurance. And how does Ephesians say? We are sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. I'm going to use an illustration that I've used with children that works really, really well. So don't freak out today. Bear with me. But I hope this illustrates exactly what it means to be sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. I like making homemade salsa. I love making homemade salsa. So I brought a can of chilies. Now, is this can sealed? The answer is yes. Who sealed it? Well, man did. There's ways that I get in this can, right? But imagine this can being sealed by God. Imagine this can being sealed by God. And God saying that no man can take them out of my Father's hand. Okay, that's Christ saying that about God. No man can take them out of my Father's hand. So this can is being sealed by God. And God says what's in it can't get out of it. That's sealed, right? Now, what can the outside world do to this can? What can the pressures of this world do to this can? What can Satan do to this can? Well, I can peel the label off of it, right? Can you tell what it is anymore? Can't tell what's in it, can you? Does the contents change? The contents do not change. They're still sealed. I can dent that can. Do the contents change? No. I can put this can in a freezer, and I can freeze it solid cold. I can be the frozen chosen. Do the contents change? No. I can heat this baby up, and I can cook the inside of it. Do the contents change? Why? It's sealed. Do you understand the sealing of the Holy Spirit? Our lives, have you ever felt frozen? You ever felt dented? You ever felt peeled? You ever felt heated up? Kicked around, thrown around, damaged goods. What's God say? You've got value. You've got purpose. You are sealed. Sealed by God. And how does that happen? That happens in Him. In Him, that happens. Not apart from Him. Not outside of Him. It happens in Him. That is the sealing of the Holy Spirit. And that happens when you walk, when you hear that Christ died for your sins, when He hung on that cross 2,000 years ago for us, for no reason than to forgive us. When you hear that, and then you say, God, that's right, and God, I'm a sinner, and God, I need that forgiveness. We talk about the forgiveness and the redemption that happens in Him. Say, God, I need that. And God's like, all right, all you got to do is believe. And when you believe, you have it. And when you believe, you're sealed. And it doesn't matter what happens on the outside. On the inside, you're still the same. And you're my child. John 1:12 says that. To as many as received Him, to them, they gave the right to become the sons of God. God gave that right. We now have the right to become His children. And we're sealed by the Spirit, untouchable by man. He cannot get us out. That's what it means to be sealed. And that's what God gives us. And that's the grace that God gives us. Ephesians is all about grace, an unmerited gift. My question is, have you received that gift? Have you been sealed? And I can't answer that question. Only you can. And how do you do that? Again, it goes to the gospel. Do you believe that Christ died for your sins and rose from the dead? Do you believe and understand that? That's what the Bible says. The Bible says that it's not my opinion anymore. It's God's opinion. And that we'll fight on. You can disagree with me all you want, but it's not me you're disagreeing with. It's God you're disagreeing with. And God says, if you believe the gospel. And you say, well, that's pretty inclusive. You know, it's not very tolerant to say that Jesus is the only way to heaven. Well, that's true. But I figure if Jesus said it, I can get by with repeating it, right? And there are many who think that there's other ways to heaven. There are many who say, well, I believe in God. Isn't that enough? Well, James says even the demons believe in God. What's the difference? Christ is the difference. Do we believe that Christ, as God's Son, died on the cross for our sins and then rose from the dead, proving He has victory? That's the difference. Have you heard the gospel? Do you believe the gospel? If you have, you are sealed and you have a full assurance of faith. So what? Well, God promises us an inheritance. But never forget, as with all inheritance, someone had to die for us to receive it. This is the thing with this. As we do that Hebrews 12, never forget that all this comes in Him because of what He did for us. He had to die first for this inheritance to be available. And we, on this Thanksgiving week especially, but even throughout, what should we do? Well, there should be some praise going into that. There should be some praise going into that because of this inheritance that we have. And let's go to Hebrews 2, verse 9 says this, but we see Him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the sufferings of death, so that by the grace of God He might taste death for everyone. Do you see the value that He's placing on us by doing this for us? And we sit there and we wonder, God, I have no value, and yet Christ died for you. You're basically shaking your fist at God and saying, God, I'm not worthy of what you did for me. Your death was useless because I am useless. And that's harsh, but sometimes that's what we do. And God says, no, you're not. I died for you. Don't ever buy into that lie that you are worthless because you have value, and I died for you to show that value. Number two, my inheritance is guaranteed by God. It's guaranteed by God. Hebrews 9:15. Therefore, He is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, since the death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. Do you see this? The promised eternal inheritance? That's what that is. The promised eternal inheritance. It never ends. It's promised, it's eternal, it never ends. Again, talking about this death that happened, since a death has occurred, in order for inheritance to come, there must be a death. And finally, number three, this should make me want to praise God. Why should I want to praise God? Well, these three things we talked about. I have value, I have reason to live, I have hope for the future. I've got value, I have reason to live, I have hope for the future. That's what I have. I've got purpose. Value, purpose, hope. Value, purpose, hope. All of those in Christ. That's what I have. And it should make me want to sing praise to God. On the front of your bulletins this week was mentioned the passage, Psalm 100. It's a psalm of thanksgiving. Psalm 100, going to Thanksgiving week this week, is a good psalm for us to remember. It's a good idea for us. And let's look at this for just a moment. Psalm 100, 1 through 3. We're going to do the whole thing, actually. But this is a psalm for giving thanks. It says this, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us. We are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever and his faithfulness to all generations. We should be praising God. These things that we have in him, not outside of him, but in him, these things that we have should be significant to us as we recognize God in you. I've got all those things we listed. I've got the grace, got the redemption, got the forgiveness, got a relationship with God. I've got hope. I've got value, purpose, reason to live. All those things happen in Christ. Vicki and Rachel are going to come up here. They're going to sing a song for us. And when they come up and sing this, I'm going to ask that you just consider your own life for just a moment. Where are you at? Are you in right fellowship? Are you even in relationship with him? We talk about being sealed, being protected by God, but it only happens in him. Have you heard the word of truth? Yeah. If you were here today, you did. Have you believed the word of truth? That's the real question. And once you do that, then you become sealed. And yet, life's going to kick you. Life's going to get you down. It's going to peel the label. It's going to dent you. It's going to hurt. But the contents will never change. That is God's assurance. Ladies are going to come up. They're going to sing this song, Sinners Saved by Grace. All of us here are sinners saved by grace. Some of us, we've never placed our faith in God for that. And now might be the time. Say, God, you know what? I know I'm a sinner, but I've never been saved by grace. Today I'm asking that you would save me so that I can be sealed. And you can do that right there in your chair. If you want to come up and talk to me, I'll be sitting right down here in the front. You can come up and talk to me. But today I challenge you, make sure that you are in right relationship with God before you leave so that you can feel the assurance of being sealed by the Spirit. And for those of us who've been sealed, this song, Sinners Saved by Grace, should touch us. Listen to the words of the ladies sing. Can I get an amen, people? Can I get an amen? God, what better way to end the service than this reminder that we're sinners saved by grace. Father, we know your word says all of us are sinners, and for those who believe in you, we become those who are saved by grace. Father, thank you for that gift and for all the gifts that come because we are in you. Father, praise you so much. I praise you for that. Help us to leave this place with new value, with new purpose, with new hope because of what you've done for us through your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You are dismissed.